Welcome back, everyone. Another exciting edition of the Success Happy Hour Experience. Welcome. Good morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are. I'm Rob from the Drunken Grape, and we've got a great discussion today. I'm bringing back one of my favorite guests, one of my great friends, Alex Czartoryski, the Polish Prince. He's also, you know, that's a minor detail, but he's actually an IT guru. He knows a lot about technology. He has built a very wildly successful entrepreneurial and personal career out of IT. And today we're going to talk about AI and its disruption in the marketplace. What's going to happen to things like ChatGPT? And we're going to talk about that. We both played around it with it. And I tell you, disruption is on its way. So as always, make sure to like and subscribe to this channel. Subscriptions really help drive it in the YouTube universe, as well as hitting the notification bell to all so you don't miss any great content. We have awesome guests and awesome engagement coming right to your phone or your screen anywhere in the world weekly. Alex, how the hell are you, buddy? What's going on? Welcome back, brother.
I'm doing great. Glad to be back. Thanks for that great intro.
Yeah, it's always a pleasure. I'm going to crack my Trappist beer while we get started, but we'll do the happy hour toast in a minute or two. I know you've got a nice, 2021 Saint Emilion, probably a village or that nature, just good all-around drinking wines. But before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about AI. What have you done in the research lately on this? I know you are very well-versed in technology, and that is your forte, in fact. What have you found with it? I mean, what's it going to do? Things like ChatGPT. First of all, what is ChatGPT for the audience?
So it's this AI-powered chat system where you talk with this artificial intelligence as if you were chatting to a human. And you can ask all kinds of questions, and it's got a huge database of knowledge that's kind of grabbed from the internet, and it answers your questions as a human would. And so it's really fun to play around with that, asking all kinds of questions and figuring out what it knows, what it doesn't know, what it answers correctly, what it doesn't answer correctly. But generally, it's really, really good. And it's interesting because this kind of came about in the past few months where there seems to be this leap from everyone's experience with their Siri phone. You ask Siri something and it's kind of useless for the most part, to all of a sudden this ChatGPT that's actually
useful,
have a useful conversation with you. And so there's been a lot of flurry and a lot of startups and companies kind of changing their entire business models around in like the period of a month after ChatGPT came out. ChatGPT is a generative pre-trained transformer. It's kind of a terrible name because no one knows what it is.
I'm never going to remember that.
No.
But cheers to that. Cheers to where AI is going in my Prud'homme beer certification class. It's funny. I'll bring notes up on ChatGPT. I asked about beer education systems and what's renowned. I'm drinking the Zundert 10. This is a Trappist, very strong ale. This is Dutch. This is monk beer. 13 monasteries throughout the world, was 14. A shell shut down and was absorbed by Westmalle, I believe, in 2021, because you have to have active members of the monastic or Trappist order within the walls doing the actual brewing to call it a Trappist beer. It's a designated region. It'd be like a DOCG in the wine world, or at the top of the protected classification pyramids, for instance, or a PDO if you go by EU wine law. It would be an AVA of like Napa Valley, for instance. Just give you an idea. Hard to believe these really complex beers. It's still cold outside. I love rich, hot, really high alcohol, or not, you know, it's got a lot of heat from the alcohol, rich, well textured. You know, there's a lot of prune, there's fig, there's always notes of like baking spice, nutmeg. You get all sorts of goodies in here, a bit of burnt or charred toffee as well. That's just some of the things that break it down. What are you drinking, my friend, in the happy, happy hour? Cheers to you. Welcome back.
Cheers, Rob. I'm drinking a red wine, Saint-Emilion Calvet.
Oh, I think I've had that before. It's quite good.
Not sure what that means, but it's a $25 bottle of wine, not anything crazy, but I like the region in general. And actually, interesting, I asked ChatGPT to give me some tasting notes on it, And its initial reaction was like, oh, I can't because that wine doesn't exist. It hasn't been bottled yet. And that's when I found out that most of ChatGPT's data is from pre-September 2021. And so instead it gave me tasting notes on the 2020 bottle. But that was interesting to kind of see the downside. But very cool where you can ask it and it gives you kind of the general idea of
yeah, I'm going to share it. I'm going to get on here and share it with everybody for a minute. I mean, you've got introducing ChatGDP. You know, I'm just going to quickly bring that up. Here it is right here. I mean, you could. I got into it literally through my Gmail account. It was effortless. It sent a phone code to, you know, do the authentication of whether it was me or not. And it was really, really simple to get into. Now, what I do want to do is share, and I'm sorry to my videographer at events, Mike, because it always creates a bit of work for him when I do stuff like this. But right here, look what we have here, the Prud'homme Beer Certification Program. And it talks all about it. You know, it breaks down, created in 2009. It's dead accurate because I'm at level 3. Like, I'm near the highest levels of this program. And it's quite cool of how it breaks. Each certification, level of certification, requires participants to complete a series of courses and exams that cover various aspects of beer, including history, styles, brewing techniques, tasting and serving, food pairing, and sensory analysis. You can see where this is just field trips to breweries and other beer-related businesses. So, you know, it keeps going on and it says, Prud'homme Beer Certification Program is recognized by the beer industry in Canada, has also gained recognition in other countries such as the United States and Australia. It is considered to be one of the most comprehensive and respected beer education programs in the world. And right under it is Cicerone, which is a similar write-up. That's also a very highly regarded program as well out of the States. Ray Daniels created that in 2007. So let's punch in here. I'm going to punch in Zundert and what it says on the beer, Zundert 10. Now, it's generating for me right now. I don't know if that's coming up on the screen or not, but what ChatGDP does is it generates or auto-generates what you're trying to do in it. I'm just going to see if this actually comes up. Here it is. This is awesome. Right in the note, Zundert 10 is a Trappist beer brewed by the Abbey Maria Tovlut in the Netherlands. Or Tovlut, I'm not sure how you would say that. It's one of 11 Trappist breweries in the world. That's actually not accurate. We're up to 13 now. So that's a cool correction. 11 was back in about 2017-18. The last 2-3 years, there's been 2 or 3 new openings. So you're right. It's sort of limited.
It's cool to ask ChatGPT then give me some foods that this beer would pair well with and see what it says.
Let's see that. You know, let's see food pairings. I bet you stew would be up on the list, like a hearty beef stew. A Caribbean black bean soup. Spicy, rich. I could see something going on with this, but it is definitely a very rich beer. It's very flavorful. What I like about it, it's got a nice hop kick in the back end to balance out with all that malt richness in the flavors. You know, beer really is composed of typically four things. It's water, malts, hops, and yeast. In this case, sometimes the Dutch throw in things like beet juice or sugar cane or hard rock candy, coriander, is a bunch of stuff that they sometimes add into it. So we're just waiting for the response. It's generating a response. Here we go, Alex. This is freaking cool. So strong and aged cheese. I could absolutely see that. Really strong cheeses. It's a strong beer. What did I say? Stews and hearty soups right off the cuff. Hey, point for Robert. Knows his job. But anyway, the other thing, roasted meats, dark chocolate, something I probably would not have typically paired this with. But yes, I could see it because it kind of has that. It has that roasted characteristic akin to coffee or espresso.
I did the other way around. So I had asked it. I told the ChatGPT, I'm having ravioli with spinach and ricotta. What wine pairing would you recommend in the $25 range?
Brilliant.
And give me three specific wines that are actually available here in Ontario, the LCBO. But assume that I'm having the spinach with the ravioli with tomato sauce. And I said, well, actually, I'm having the ravioli with butter sauce. Can you suggest other wines? And I said, oh, well, we recommend these white wines. And I was like, oh, well, I'd prefer to have a red wine. Could you recommend a red wine? And so I went through this whole conversation process to drill down to the right wine, which is pretty neat. And
that is neat. That's cool. You know, I think this is going to be positive disruption. I know for my industry, it's going to help me because you can't replace somebody doing live presentations in front of corporations, businesses, and government bodies. But what it
Certainly, even in places where you feel there might be a disruption, people shouldn't be afraid of this. They should embrace it and try and see how they could leverage ChatGPT to
absolutely
facilitate their workflows. Yeah.
Yes, I mean for clients that want to get a jump on what I'm talking about, you know, not the aficionado or the enthusiasts who already have a base level of education. Who are going to sample and dive into these things. They already have Delectable or Vivino or the LCBO app on their phone, which will mimic some of these things. Not as direct or as user-friendly in the sense that you can just type in your query and get an instant answer. This is like the rudimentary forms of Jarvis coming from the movie Iron Man. You know, you can see this eventually speaking with you and you can see where this is going. But to help people be prepared for my presentations or other presentations of professional sommeliers who have the ability to present in front of large audiences, well, this is definitely an asset. And I see it as an asset for information booths and querying, quite frankly. Yes, it's going to disrupt some things job-wise, but it's also going to open up a whole doorway to a lot of new and innovative paths. You can see where this is. I think this is a net massive positive. What about you?
Yeah, for sure. I think anytime that there's a new technology, I mean, we see it even with electric trucks that they're possibly going to disrupt all the truck drivers. There's definitely some churn there, but there's negatives and positives. But overall, I think it advances things and allows for more productivity and more efficiency and ultimately more opportunity, I think. But it's a big unknown, but I think embracing these technologies helps you prepare for that kind of things.
And you know, again, not all drivers are going to be displaced. You still need physical drivers handling certain things in certain aspects. In fact, it's probably not going to disrupt that high level trade that much, but it will introduce aspects where you can reduce the number of drivers on the road at any point in time. If you can automate part of it, I mean, self-driving is still forever ending. The debate on that is what do you do if you get hacked? I think what'll happen is it'll be limited use. You know, areas where people aren't really walking around or roaming around straight past mining, for instance, you know, mines where it's these massive trucks go from one payload to another and it's just a straight line of driving. You could probably automate all that. In truth, you could probably go driverless. You could probably go electric eventually. It's going to happen. It's inevitable. It's I don't think I'd want to get into a self-flying plane. I don't know about that, Alex.
But there's some available.
Yeah, but there's definitely disruption is here. And I love your thoughts on it because you can't dodge it. Putting your head in the sand is only going to make you a victim in it. And I think I embraced it. I thought it was pretty cool what this thing had to say and do. And I'm excited to see what OpenAI – is it OpenAI? Is that the name of the company that produced it? I'm excited to see what they develop as far as paying, as far as the AI interface, as far as starting to talk with you like Alexis or Siri. It's definitely going to have an interesting spin on how things go.
Yeah, I know kind of the upcoming things that, or one that's already available is where you could feed ChatGPT your own custom data set. So for example, you could have it, let's say you feed into it all the content from like an antiques roadshow or something, and all of a sudden ChatGPT can start predicting the value of some antique furniture or that kind of stuff, or it could feed it into your entire email database, for example, and then it'll know a lot of information about you and could become a personal assistant to you almost and know all those things. And then the next big leap apparently that's going to happen is that ChatGPT will learn how to use third-party tools. So, for example, if you ask it a math question, it will know to open up the calculator app and type in the formula required to get the answer. And that opens up a whole new world of possibilities where you could start asking it to find the best price on flights, for example, or start booking vacations.
Oh, yeah. No, you could see where this, or a wine guide. Where do I find the best price on that St. Emilion wine, the Calvert that you're drinking? Or where can I find Zundert? Because this is hard to find. Where is it available? ChatGPT, help me out. And you never know.
You'll always need someone to taste the wine. And give that initial review of it.
Right. And you're going to have somebody as a live presenter in front of you. You're still going to have sommeliers and bartenders present this stuff in a restaurant or a server. None of that's getting replaced. What I think it does is it makes it easier to upsell big time. Because if I could just go to my phone and go right at dinner, you're with your girlfriend or your wife, you know, you sit down, you're like, well, what is going to go well with this prime rib in this restaurant? And you ask ChatGPT, you can turn to the sommelier and say, do you have this? Do you have any recommendations to flow off this? I mean, that just makes your choices a lot quicker and a lot easier too. The time saved. And the time saved for the person selling it. If I can flip a $500 bottle of wine very quickly at a high-end recommendation onto the next table instead of taking minutes or tens of minutes to determine it, that is a huge assistance to itself.
Yeah, or if you're a restaurant with a large menu, you could theoretically ask ChatGPT to pick a wine pairing out of your list of wines you have in your cellar for every single meal. And it should theoretically do a good job. There could be mistakes, but it's a pretty big time saver. And then the sommelier just needs to go through the list and make sure there's no kind of blatant errors, and that saved them a ton of time right there.
Well, that's just it. You want to save time. Time is your biggest friend, and it's your most important asset, or it could be your biggest enemy, how you use it. I could tell you that one of the things that a lot of people don't enjoy doing is the administrative task of creating those wine lists. And the owner has to rely on the sommelier being there. You have to come in extra hours. You have to come in and, you know, you have to plan around their schedule of selling on the floor or actually managing the team as to how to sell, training at the same time. You got this administrative responsibility that happens really seasonally because the chef changes the menu. I think this is brilliant. You go, hey, ChatGPT, what do I do to pair with this and this and give them the list? And from there, it's up to you to streamline it. The professional will just come in and go, yep, that makes sense. Okay, that could be tweaked a little bit, but they're still on the right path. And the owner could present that as a draft. Think of the labor saving. Instead of hours, it's literally ripped down into half an hour from hours.
Yeah, certainly in the software development space, which is my background, there's ChatGPT can streamline a lot of things. It's really good at translating from one programming language to another. It's good at explaining code or even commenting code. And it's got a lot of interesting tools there to really, like, if you're a software developer, to help you write code faster.
Tourism. Look what I did here for you. You're going to St. Francis or St. Francois, Guadeloupe. Yeah. Look at this. I said, what's there to do? Look at the list it gave me. I don't think we're even in the bottom of the list, but right off the bat, beaches, golfing, water sports, island hopping, nature and wildlife, dining and shopping. That's things you and your wife love doing. I think that's just like six things off the top of the head that you and Stephanie have absolutely no problems engaging in.
And you can get all this by doing a search on Google, but it'll take you more time. Here's kind of a one question and press all that information.
Yeah, if I was Google right now, I'd be nervous of this because I'm looking at this going, shit, this just populates information so much more quicker, so much more quickly than somebody punching in, okay, best things to do in St. Francois, All right. Well, Google has like three or four different links. I got to siphon through the information. This just blasted it as a summation of exactly what somebody would be looking for in a one pager. I mean,
that's certainly,
you just go down. It's still like, I mean, look at this. Six things broken down.
Yeah,
great Bing, selection of Bing. Restaurants, com. Cafes,
so Microsoft
and shops.
Has jumped onto this and kind of integrated a chat into their search engine because they're thinking more and more people, instead of searching on Google, are just going to ask ChatGPT. And so that's definitely a disruption risk for Google, because they get most of their revenue from ads. And so they would have to figure out, okay, how do we make money off of these chats or these AIs?
Right. That's a lot easier. Yeah. Yeah. And don't you think it would be a lot easier for a company like Apple to pivot into this than Google, because of all the hardware that they already sell, the phones and the computers?
Yeah, it's mind-boggling that Siri hasn't adopted this yet. Or I think like that's where Siri can give a good answer like this, because currently Siri is just
terrible.
Can't even get my wife's name right when I'm trying to call her. So it's like,
yeah, it screws up the surname of so many of my friends when I ask Siri to make a phone call for me off my headset. Whereas this is flawless. I'm actually, you know, I was hesitant because, you know, we naturally are. Oh my God, it's disruptive. Don't want to look at that. But I actually checked it out this morning, finally. And I can tell you, I'm actually bubbling with enthusiasm to hack around with this thing a bit more. It's just going to make things life a lot easier. You know, there's definitely some inherent advantages to this technology.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
It's so what else cool. Go ahead, brother. It's okay.
No, it makes you feel better that ChatGPT screws up sometimes and isn't perfect.
True.
Because it's still it's human in the kind of way where it makes mistakes. It is.
I asked it about woke, you know, and then I criticized woke. You know, it says it's all embracing of humanity and different cultures. And I wrote to it saying, yes, in an idealistic way. But what about human bias and natural prejudice and the rampant racism that's always going to exist? And what about things that go against people's narratives? And the answer was actually quite striking. It wrote back to me saying, yes, human biases do predicate and they do dictate and they do damage often what is factual or what is true or what is the premise of something. I was like, you know what, ChatGPT, that's a point. That's a point. For you. I actually had to sit back and go, that's a pretty good answer.
Yeah, it's one of the dangers of ChatGPT is that there are kind of safeguards and biases built into it in the background. So I think a famous one was that if you ask it to name the positives about Donald Trump, it says, oh, I can't comment about political people, but then if you ask the same thing about Barack Obama, it gave a bunch of positive stuff. So
it has a bias programmed into it, and that's one of the big criticisms of it right now. But as a functioning tool, and for anybody with bias, because we all have bias, shelf your bias and try this out. I would say just get on this thing and give it a whirl. Test it out in your profession.
How easy it is to access too. So if you very, very easy to access. You don't need to be technical. You just connect with it. If you have a Google account, you connect with a Google account and you just start asking questions like a chat. So
you can see right there on that note, Google is obviously starting to work with them on integration right away. Because the fact that you can just take a Gmail account and connect immediately, Google's onto something with this. I wouldn't be surprised, Alex, I'm going to put this out there, that Google buys this company out.
So Microsoft has purchased them already, I believe, or has invested in them. But certainly everyone is getting into the game for sure. I'm surprised again. I'm shocked by how bad Siri is.
Terrible,
and it's almost like. Apple's purposely not made it better or has something in the background. But yeah, like you can imagine. So right now it's a chat based thing, but you can imagine once you could just speak into your phone and ask it anything that, you know, could just,
thinking of Apple and technology and where it's going to go with its own AI interfaces, you know, Apple is not the creator of a smartphone. It was BlackBerry. What Apple's brilliant at is coming in and just doing it a whole lot better than everybody else once it figures it out. That is their forte. Yeah, it always has been.
It's the second mover advantage.
And they're so good at putting in such a dominant stake that they forever make everybody play catch up. Look at the iPhone. Everybody plays catch up to the iPhone. Everybody shifted gears into the style of how it looked, how it was built, how it was constructed. The ease and the flow of just moving around in apps and sliding your screen around is still superior to all the other phones out there. And suspect, you know, I'm not pro anybody. I'm actually quite happy that there's new movers and shakers in the technology space. But I could see them definitely coming up with something very strong. But hats off to OpenAI.
It's been a project that they've been on for a while. So it seems like it just came out of nowhere, but it's got years of effort behind it that culminated. But maybe a last thing on AI and kind of the dangers of AI. Traditionally, what people have been talking about, the danger of AI, is kind of this concept of the singularity, where imagine, so ChatGPT is very, really good at taking code and simplifying it. Well, imagine you're in a scenario where you give ChatGPT the code for itself. So the ChatGPT code, you give it to ChatGPT and you tell it, okay, improve this code to make it a little bit better. And then it creates the next version of ChatGPT. And you do the same thing to the next version with, hey, take your own code and make it better. And the concept of that eventually the software starts self-improving itself very, very rapidly until it becomes super intelligent and knows everything and figures out, hey, humans are bad for the planet. I'm going to take over.
Like Skynet.
Yeah. And that's probably similarity because as it starts improving itself, it starts getting smarter and smarter. So it can improve itself faster and faster. And so you get this point where all of a sudden just goes like, and it becomes super intelligent and it's too late.
Well, what if humans are chipped into that intelligence?
Yeah, it's the implementation.
What if that's coming in the future? You know, what if our best scientists and researchers get chipped into AI intelligence?
It'll be interesting with all like the Neuralink stuff that Elon Musk is working on, where it could communicate via wavelengths of mind. It's going to be interesting how all that works. And I mean, in a sense, we're already kind of progressing there, where everyone's got a smartphone in their hands and has access to like the internet's knowledge. And pretty soon it's going to be the chat stuff. And even if it's not directly plugged into the mind, even if it's an audio thing where ChatGPT can whisper you all the answers, to a conversation you're having.
But it could also be used to benevolently uplift all of humanity. It's like blockchain and decentralized finance. If you can democratize finance, imagine democratizing all learning across this planet, what that could do.
That's certainly huge opportunities. Also, I think huge risks for people to use it for self gain and their own wealth, but that's the case with everything
that's always been a human concern. I mean, even if you look at the tensions rising in the world right now, this is just sort of a rehash of the 1920s into the 30s into World War II. Let's hope we skip the World War II part into World War III. But the same fears, the comment and the point here is the same fears and the same issues that we often experience today have been around since civilization started. People are always worried about what's going to replace them. There's always something new. And those that adopt and those that embrace do forever better than those that sit back and are reactive. It's best to be responsive.
I think like one of the things you could count on in life is that there's going to be change.
Absolutely.
And a lot of people have this concept that like, oh, if I can only get these things done, finally I'll be at peace and I'll be able to let sit back and relax. That never happens. There's always something new that comes along with it.
Yes, and the sooner it's true, and the sooner you realize that, the easier it all gets. In a warped way, it actually does. If you realize that, it's just constant. It's like an MMO video game where it never ends. That you're always playing the next module or component in a full open world, which AI is totally going to enhance too. It'll never end. You always have to upgrade your equipment and your gear. While in life, you always have to upgrade your intelligence. You always have to upgrade your skill sets. You cannot rest on your laurels. The day that you sit back saying, ha ha, I've conquered it, is day you're probably wise to retire from what you're doing. Don't stay in that game. That's my advice anyway.
Challenge yourself and put stress on yourself to learn and improve and grow.
It's true. Listen, you are always a tremendous guest. I love this topic. I love your setup. I see the Ray Dalio book by your head over there. Quite the nice bookcase in there, brother. Quite a nice collection.
In my office,
in your home. That's a cool setup in there. You got love the baby globe by your head too. I mean, no, it's good setup. Good setup for sure. But always a pleasure to have you on the show. You're like one of my favorite reoccurring guests. You're like the technology hub for the show, and it's something that people can't neglect, man. Tap into ChatGPT. Check it out, ladies and gentlemen. If you have any questions, contact Alex. If you're a business and you want to explore more into how technology can be used to disrupt to benefit you, contact him. He's a high-priced consultant. He's worth every penny. Get him on board. Listen, brother, you've been a great guest. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever you decide to do, have a terrific day. This is Robin Alex from Trappist.